So we'll do a little Q&A at the end. Good afternoon. Welcome, everyone. I'm Chris Schrader. I direct the program on public law here at the law school. This is the third in our series of lessons learned lectures. Today, the topic is civil rights. What's happened of note in the area of civil rights during the Bush administration, and what lessons might be taken as we move forward into the next administration from that. I'll give you advance warning that next week, Pam Carlin will be talking on Halloween on the subject of voting rights. I don't know whether that's an appropriate day for such a topic or not, but that we'll do that on October 31st. And as always, these events are being co-sponsored with the Journal on Constitutional Law and Policy, which will be publishing the lectures. Today's speaker is Goodwin Liu, someone eminently qualified to speak on the subject of human rights. Goodwin holds degrees from Stanford, Yale, and Oxford, where he was a Rhodes Scholar. After graduating from Yale Law in 1998, he clerked for Judge David Tatel on the D.C. Circuit, and then for Justice Ginsburg on the Supreme Court. He's held positions at the U.S. Department of Education with AmeriCorps and in private practice as an appellate litigator at the firm of O'Melveny & Myers in Washington. Goodwin sits on the board of directors of the American Constitution Society. He's a member of the Board of Trustees of Stanford University, as well as serving on other boards. His scholarship focuses on civil rights, constitutional law, education policy. While at Berkeley, where he is a newly minted tenured professor at the law school, he also co-directs the Earl Warren Legal Institute on Race, Ethnicity, and Diversity. And he just told me he's accepted some responsibilities in administration as associate dean for curriculum and other topics there at Bolt Hall, as we used to call the place. Some of us old-timers can't give up the old name. It's wonderful to have Goodwin with us today, and I hope you would join me in welcoming him to the podium.
Thank you very much. I'm very pleased to be here at Duke, and also very pleased to be in the swing state of North Carolina. I walked into the building today, and one great thing about this talk is that I've always wanted to have a poster of myself with President Bush's picture right next to me. So that's going to be a souvenir for me from this trip. Well, the subject of the Bush administration and civil rights is a very broad one, and when I shared this topic with a colleague of mine over the weekend, he sort of chuckled and he said, well, isn't that sort of like shooting fish in a barrel? What I'll try to do today is not offer simply a catalog of complaints, but actually try to think about what the Bush administration's legacy in this area teaches us about where the nation is on the question of civil rights. And I realize that the term civil rights is a very broad term. It encompasses, for many people, a whole range of subjects, ranging from racial equality to women's equality, disability rights, immigrants' rights. But I'm going to talk more specifically about the subject of racial equality and the dynamic that was initiated by Brown versus the Board of Education and the Civil Rights Act of 1964, and kind of think about where we are on some of those struggles today. My talk will be in two parts. In the first part, I will talk about the enforcement machinery of the federal government, namely the Civil Rights Division of the Justice Department, and what has happened there over the last 8 years. And then the second part of my talk, I will talk more specifically about initiatives that are more personally associated with President Bush and examine the question of presidential leadership in the area of civil rights. So first part will be more about the bureaucracy. Second will be thinking more about what has come directly out of President Bush and the White House. So let me dive right in. As by way of background, the Civil Rights Division of the Justice Department is the nation's foremost civil rights enforcement agency. And for five decades, it has had a very venerable role in this vein. Its early challenges to voting discrimination in the South laid the groundwork for the Voting Rights Act of 1965. During the 1960s, the division was instrumental in activating enforcement of Brown in recalcitrant states and school districts. In the 70s, the division's aggressive enforcement of Title VII of the Civil Rights Act of 1964 secured employment opportunities for qualified women and minorities. And through these efforts and many, many others, the division established a legacy of federal leadership in promoting fair opportunity and equal citizenship for all Americans. Against this historical backdrop, the record of the Civil Rights Division under President Bush, I think, provides a stark contrast. And I'm going to offer just a few examples from two major areas of enforcement, voting and employment. So the Department of Justice is responsible for enforcing the anti-discrimination guarantees of the Voting Rights Act of 1965. And among these guarantees is Section 2's prohibition on any voting practice, procedure, or qualification that denies equal opportunity to participate in the political process based on race, color, or membership in a language minority group. Historically, the Civil Rights Division has used Section 2 to combat minority vote dilution, which happens from redistricting schemes that pack or crack minority voters. Pam Carlin, I'm sure, will talk more about this next week, or from the creation or maintenance of at-large voting districts instead of single-member districts. Over the past 8 years, the Bush administration has filed a total of 14 Section 2 cases. This marks the lowest rate of Section 2 litigation by any presidential administration since the 1982 amendments to the Voting Rights Act. Further, only 7 of the 14 cases involved a claim of minority vote dilution, and only 3 cases were filed on behalf of black voters. By contrast, during the last 6 years of the Clinton administration, the Civil Rights Division filed 14 vote dilution cases and 8 Section 2 cases on behalf of African Americans. The administration's record in this area suggests that it has displaced the traditional concern for the voting rights of black Americans with a predominant focus on Hispanic voters. 10 of the administration's 14 Section 2 cases involve Hispanic voters. And in addition, the Civil Rights Division has significantly increased the number of suits filed under the language access provisions of the Voting Rights Act. So during the Bush administration, the Civil Rights Division has filed 28 language access suits. All but one of those suits assert claims on behalf of Hispanic voters. In addition to enforcing voting rights, the Department of Justice also enforces Title VII of the Civil Rights Act against state and local government employers. So Section 706 authorizes the Attorney General to file suit against a public employer in cases involving an individual charge of discrimination that's been referred to the Justice Department by the EEOC. And then separately, Section 707 authorizes the Attorney General to sue public employers that engage in a pattern or practice of discrimination. The Section 707 cases are especially important because they are very complex and expensive to pursue. They affect a large number of employees, and they often break new legal ground. In its 8 years, the Clinton administration filed 92 complaints under Title VII, or more than 11 per year. By contrast, the Bush administration has filed 54 complaints, or roughly 7 per year. Moreover, the current administration has filed only 14 pattern or practice suits under Section 707, among which only 4 allege racial discrimination against African Americans, while 2 allege racial discrimination against whites. Among the 43 complaints filed under Section 706 over the past 8 years, 10 allege discrimination against African Americans, 3 allege discrimination against whites. It is doubtful that this enforcement pattern reflects the prevalence, relatively speaking, and severity of discrimination against blacks and whites today. The empirical research suggests otherwise. But the Justice Department has managed to make significant headlines with reverse discrimination suits. Now, before going further, let me acknowledge a very familiar but nonetheless important point. Whatever disagreement that I or you or we might have with the interpretations of the civil rights laws that the Bush administration has taken. The administration, like all presidential administrations, is entitled to set priorities and to shape enforcement in accordance with its policy goals. So, while the Bush administration has not aggressively enforced employment or voting rights, especially on behalf of blacks, it has devoted significant resources to other issues. So, for example, the criminal section of the Civil Rights Division has vigorously enforced the prohibition on human trafficking, in particular sex trafficking, in the Trafficking Victims Protection Act passed in 2000. In addition, the Justice Department has pursued a very visible campaign to protect religious liberty and to combat religious discrimination in employment, education, housing, and public accommodations. And further, President Bush supported and signed recently the ADA amendments of 2008, which overruled several Supreme Court decisions in order to broaden the protective reach of the Americans with Disabilities Act. Nevertheless, I want to say the following, which is that in our constitutional system, executive discretion in interpreting and enforcing duly enacted laws, while very broad, is conditioned to a large extent upon technical competence and political accountability. The delegation of law enforcement discretion is not an authorization to act on political whim. It instead assumes a degree of even-handedness rooted in professional expertise and institutional tradition, as well as the operation of checks and balances that subject enforcement priorities to public scrutiny. These safeguards against undue politicization are nowhere more important than in the Department of Justice, and especially in the Civil Rights Division. By this measure, I think, there is cause for some deeper concern. The Bush administration has not merely shifted enforcement priorities, but has done so in the context of a highly politicized and largely unaccountable decisional structure. As a result, the division has taken positions antithetical to the interests of minority groups where the applicable law or available evidence counseled otherwise. Perhaps the most troubling incidents have occurred in the department's handling of preclearance submissions under Section 5 of the Voting Rights Act. Under Section 5, a covered state or local jurisdiction, which is so designated because of its past discriminatory practices, must obtain a federal preclearance before implementing any change in voting procedures. The Justice Department reviews voting changes to ensure that they don't have a discriminatory purpose or a discriminatory effect. As an internal check on partisan influence in this process, the department has traditionally assigned responsibility for investigating preclearance submissions and issuing recommendations to the career staff of the voting section. The staff recommendation is presented to the Assistant Attorney General for Civil Rights in a memorandum analyzing the facts and relevant law, and historically, through Republican and Democratic administrations, the political leadership has rarely disagreed with staff recommendations, and when disagreement has occurred, political leaders have explained in writing their reasons for rejecting staff recommendations. In recent years, this process has been badly undermined. So in December of 2001, the Justice Department received a preclearance submission for a new congressional redistricting plan ordered by a Mississippi state court. While this submission was pending, the Republican Party persuaded a federal court to order an alternative plan if the state court plan was not precleared by February 27, 2002, which was the end of the official 60-day window for the Justice Department review. Okay? After reviewing the submission within this window, the career staff unanimously agreed that the state court plan complied with Section 5 and recommended that it be precleared. But the political staff rejected the recommendation and instead extended the review period to seek more information from the state on whether the fact that a state court and not a state legislature had ordered the plan would affect preclearance, even though there was no legal basis to think that it would. So when the February 27 deadline passed, with no preclearance decision from the Justice Department, the federal court put in place the Republican-favored plan. Partisan influence also appeared to infect the department's handling of the Texas mid-decade congressional redistricting plan conceived by House Majority Leader Tom DeLay. in a very detailed 73-page memorandum analyzing the impact of the plan on minority voting strength, a seven-member team of nonpartisan career staff, along with the section chief of voting, unanimously determined that the plan would have retrogressive effect and recommended against preclearance. But the department, without explanation, pre-cleared the plan in December of 2003, and the Texas Republican delegation gained 5 seats in Congress in 2004. 2 years later, the Supreme Court held that the plan violated Section 2 of the Voting Rights Act by improperly diluting Latino voting strength. Further, in August of 2005, the department pre-cleared a Georgia law requiring government-issued photo identification in order to vote at the polls just one day after a 51-page staff memorandum had recommended against preclearance. The reviewing staff, by a 4-to-1 vote, determined that, quote, blacks will disparately impacted compared to whites based on the totality of the evidence, and that the state failed to show non-retrogression because it never, quote, conducted any analysis or presented any data regarding racial disparities in access to various forms of photo ID. After the law went into effect, a federal court enjoined its enforcement on constitutional grounds, finding that it, quote, imposes severe restrictions on the right to vote, constitutes a poll tax, and is most likely to prevent Georgia's elderly, poor, and African-American voters from voting. Partisan considerations, I fear, appear to have influenced other voting rights matters, too. The Civil Rights Division opted to file, for example, 3 amicus briefs on the eve of the 2004 election in the battleground states of Florida, Michigan, and Ohio, arguing that there is no prior right of action to enforce the counting of provisional ballots under the Help America Vote Act, HAVA. In all 3 cases, the courts squarely rejected the Justice Department's position. Moreover, in enforcing the National Voter Registration Act, the department has been more interested in getting states and local jurisdictions to remove ineligible voters from the rolls, despite no evidence of fraud, than in protecting the right of eligible voters to have access to registration opportunities. These signs of partisanship have been part of a broader pattern of undue and, in some cases, unlawful political influence in the Justice Department's handling of other matters. Within the Civil Rights Division, the political leadership reassigned many career employees who were seen as insufficiently loyal to the administration's political views. Regular channels of communication between political appointees and career attorneys on policy issues were greatly narrowed or eliminated. Political leaders also took control of hiring decisions, abandoning long-standing hiring practices that relied principally on the career staff's professional nonpartisan judgment. This shift resulted in substantially increased hiring of attorneys with strong conservative credentials but little or no background in civil rights. After an extensive investigation, the Justice Department's Inspector General recently this summer concluded that political appointees in charge of hiring for the Honors Program and the Summer Law Intern Program, quote, took political or ideological affiliations into account in screening candidates in violation of department policy and federal law. In a separate report, the Inspector General found that several political employees violated federal law and department policy by considering political or ideological affiliations in screening candidates for AUSA positions, immigration judge positions, and other career positions. The lesson learned for me from this experience is that existing safeguards are not sufficient to protect against the politicization of civil rights enforcement. Many of those safeguards take the form of agency practices and traditions established over the decades to strike an appropriate balance between even-handed law enforcement and the legitimate prerogatives of each administration to set priorities. Hopefully, new political leaders will be willing to restore and adhere to the traditional safeguards. The problem, however, is that informal safeguards do not provide an adequate check when political leaders are prepared to disregard them. So the abuses of the current administration suggest that additional mechanisms are needed to ensure the fair administration of civil rights laws. As a starting point, we might ask, what role might Congress play? Well, in theory, Congress is the president's political rival and the ultimate overseer of policy development and implementation. Congressional oversight is supposed to ensure transparency in executive action and to broadly ensure faithful execution of the laws. But the immediate difficulty in this conception, evident, I think, in recent years, is that the conventional concept of interbranch competition has been substantially displaced by competition between political parties as the primary factor that regulates the separation of powers between Congress and the president. It is little wonder, for example, that Congress exercised virtually no meaningful oversight of the Civil Rights Division between the midterm election of 2002 and the midterm election of 2006, in which the Republicans controlled both houses of Congress and in which the deep politicization of civil rights enforcement occurred. Except for one brief hearing in 2004, neither the House nor the Senate convened an oversight hearing to examine the activities of the Civil Rights Division during the 4 years of one-party rule. The recent erosion of checks and balances during one-party rule has prompted proposals to empower the minority party in Congress, for example, by allowing the minority to conduct oversight hearings or by requiring a supermajority vote to authorize certain kinds of executive action. These may be good ideas, I don't know, but there is a practical hurdle. Under what circumstances today would the ruling majority agree to enact such minority-empowering measures? In periods of divided government, it is highly unlikely that the legislative majority would opt to strengthen the president's party in Congress. And as we now sit on the brink of another period of one-party rule, the thought of newly elected Democrats enacting safeguards for the benefit of Republican minority seems fanciful, just as it is naive to think that the Republican majority was at all interested in empowering the Democratic minority between 2002 and 2006. So the problem is that it's unclear how new minority protections could gain traction precisely because our political system is so polarized today. Moreover, even if Congress were to authorize more oversight, there remains a basic question concerning the efficacy of oversight in light of several institutional obstacles. Congress lacks information and expertise that the executive branch has. Congress faces collective action problems that weaken the impetus to protect legislative prerogatives. The monitoring capacities of congressional committees are dwarfed by the sheer scale of executive branch operations. And in the eyes of the public, Congress may suffer a credibility gap vis-a-vis the president. The oversight of civil rights enforcement is not exempt from these challenges, so they should induce, I think, a sober assessment of what we can realistically expect from the oversight mechanism. That is not to say that vigilant oversight of the Civil Rights Division from 2002 to 2006 would have made no difference, but it is to say that reliably curbing or preventing abuse of executive discretion will in all likelihood require not only interbranch, but also intrabranch solutions. So let me turn to the latter. The recent politicization of civil rights enforcement gives rise to a powerful impulse to proceduralize and professionalize the administration of law. Indeed, stronger internal checks are needed in the Justice Department. But at the same time, there is a risk that moving the pendulum too far in the other direction will create undue obstacles to presidential leadership and innovation. Many important changes will need to come from the appointment of new leaders with unimpeachable integrity and from the tone, priorities, and informal norms they establish. But with that in mind, let me suggest three strategies. First, better insulating the career staff from political caprice. Second, enhancing transparency in agency decision-making. And third, pushing important decisions up the agency hierarchy in order to foster accountability. None of these measures would directly limit the substantive policy goals that a given administration may wish to pursue, but they would improve transparency and accountability in pursuit of these goals. So first, the importance of the career staff. In the Justice Department, as in other agencies, it lies in the expertise, nonpartisanship, and long-term perspective they bring to the executing the law. Friction between career staff and the political appointees is not surprising given the different time horizons that shape their approach to law enforcement, the indeterminacy of some legal norms, and the lack of a concrete client. Such friction is by design, I think, an internal check that leavens the department's pursuit of administration policy with attention to institutional history and core law enforcement duties. This internal check cannot function appropriately unless career staff are hired on the basis of merit and not politics. And once hired, they must have the practical ability to make professional judgments without fear of political retribution. The politicization of personnel decisions during the Bush administration occurred not because of substantive gaps in existing law, but because political leaders violated clear prohibitions. Many recommendations now circulating focus on training department employees on the personnel rules. Although this is needed, I think what is most troubling about the most recent period is that improper acts of politicization continued for many years, with the first official accounting of those acts by the Inspector General issued just this year, 2008. The failure to correct improper personnel decisions in real time raises serious questions about the adequacy of existing mechanisms for complaint, investigation, and remedy. So clarifying and communicating the appropriate procedure for reporting allegations of misconduct will be essential going forward. Equally important, I think, is the need for genuine accountability when misconduct has been found. An employee who has committed a prohibited personnel practice may be subject to discipline up to and including discharge, demotion, suspension, reprimand, 5-year debarment from federal employment, and a civil fine of $1,000. But these disciplinary options do not apply to Senate-confirmed presidential appointees. Further, the recent Inspector General reports observe that political appointees who have violated the law, but who have voluntarily resigned from the department, are no longer subject to discipline by the department for their actions. On its face, this seems a peculiar rule for an agency whose mission is, I check the website, to seek just punishment for those guilty of unlawful behavior. That's a quote. Should we allow voluntary resignation to confer immunity for unlawful conduct? Well, think about it this way. If employees who embezzle Department of Justice funds cannot escape punishment by resigning, shouldn't the same rule apply to employees who unlawfully rob the department of its most precious asset, namely its credibility in the fair and impartial administration of justice? In addition to stronger personnel policies, there is a need for greater transparency in the Justice Department's enforcement decisions. This is perhaps most true with respect to the Section 5 preclearance process, because preclearance decisions, as we saw in the Texas case, can directly affect who gets elected to office. In this process, the department's role is essentially adjudicatory, and in most cases, it is final. A decision to preclear certifies that a voting change satisfies Section 5 and is not judicially reviewable. A decision to object does not bar the submitting jurisdiction from going to federal court to get a contrary ruling, but this litigation option is very rarely used. Under current law, a decision to object must be accompanied by a written explanation. However, the department's traditional practice has been to send a pretty cursory letter. This inhibits public understanding of the Section 5 process and effectively shields the application of Section 5 from careful scrutiny. Just as the litigation option for preclearance typically results in a decision supported by a written record, the administrative preclearance process should do the same in order to foster public confidence that the law is being applied consistently from case to case. Also, this disclosure requirement should apply not only to decisions to object, but also to decisions to preclear any voting change that presents a substantial question under Section 5. Finally, another way to foster accountability is to assign responsibility for key decisions to higher levels of political authority within the Justice Department. Now, this may seem counterintuitive in light of what I said earlier on strengthening the role of career staff. But consider an analogy here to the idea of presidential administration, which Elena Kagan at Harvard describes as a mode of governance that enhances transparency, enabling the public to comprehend more accurately the sources and nature of bureaucratic power, and that establishes an electoral link between the public and the bureaucracy, including the latter's responsiveness to the former. Of course, I think that's my phone. Please turn yourself Of course, moving decisions up the Department of Justice hierarchy is not the same as moving decisions onto the president's desk, because neither the Attorney General nor his political subordinates have the same visibility or electoral accountability as the president. Moreover, there are very good reasons not to subject law enforcement decisions to direct presidential control. But because the Attorney General and presidential appointees in the department are publicly identified with the president, decision-making by those leaders comes with at least some of the visibility, political responsibility, and publicizing of the bureaucracy that presidential administration entails. Now, moving key decisions up the political hierarchy also raises a couple concerns. First, there is a practical limit to the number of decisions that the Attorney General or other top officials can meaningfully make. Loading their inboxes with a bunch of decisions that they must personally own may simply lead to indecision or delay. And second, assigning more decisions to top officials may actually dilute accountability if monitoring mechanisms cannot keep pace. It may be politically difficult, for example, to hail the Attorney General before a congressional committee more than once or twice a year. The time and political bandwidth available in such hearings may be insufficient to probe the full range of decisions for which the Attorney General is personally responsible. So if that's the case, maybe it's better to assign decisions to subordinate officers whom a congressional committee could more easily and regularly call to testify. So the challenge then is to establish appropriate filters so that the locus of decision-making appropriately calibrates the importance of a given decision with the desired degree of accountability. The next administration should examine whether the current filters are working properly. For example, the Attorney General has delegated responsibility for Section 5 determinations to the Assistant Attorney General for civil rights. And the authority to pre-clear a voting change, but not to object to one, has been further delegated to the chief of the voting section. These delegations work well in most cases. But for the few cases of very serious controversy and consequence, maybe it makes sense to assign non-delegable authority to the Attorney General. One possible filter in this regard is to task the Attorney General with the final decision in the rare cases where the department ultimately rejects the staff recommendation. As we have seen, those are the cases where transparency and accountability are most needed. These proposals and many others will soon be the subject of active discussion in a new administration. That discussion must begin with the recognition that the Justice Department occupies a special place in the United States government. The American people rightly expect the department, more than any other agency, to act with integrity, impartiality, and respect for the rule of law. Each administration is entitled to its policy priorities, but no administration is entitled to corrupt the process of law enforcement for partisan ends. And this admonition applies with special force to the instruments of government charged with protecting the historically disenfranchised members of our society. Okay, deep breath. Enforcement of the civil rights laws is just the bare minimum of executive responsibility. So let me now say a few words about other activities that speak to President Bush's legacy on civil rights. Because presidential leadership, or lack thereof, provides a rough barometer of public attitudes and concerns, focusing on actions personally associated with President Bush may help us interpret where the nation stands on civil rights. So I'll offer a few insights in this vein by discussing three topics. First, the administration's amicus brief in the University of Michigan affirmative action cases. Second, the No Child Left Behind Act. And third, Hurricane Katrina. So first, putting all Sarah Palin jokes aside, it is rare for a president to speak at length to the American public about a Supreme Court case. It is rare. And it is even more rare, perhaps unprecedented, for a president to go on national television for the specific purpose of explaining his legal position in a pending case. But that is what President Bush did on Wednesday afternoon, January 16, 2003, in a 7-minute address from the Roosevelt Room of the White House discussing the Michigan affirmative action cases. Now, a fair reading of this address is that it was a sop to the conservative base. Most of his words were devoted to explaining why the undergraduate and the law school affirmative action policies amounted to racial quota, and quota systems, the president said, are divisive, unfair, and impossible to square with the Constitution. But the most significant aspect of the speech, it turns out, was what the president did not say. And what the president did not say became clearer the next day when, just minutes before the Supreme Court's midnight deadline, the Solicitor General of the United States filed the government's amicus briefs in the Michigan cases. Rest assured that procrastination of this sort does not occur because the Justice Department is short-staffed. There's a backstory. So a decade ago, when I graduated from law school, it is fair to say that things did not bode well for affirmative action in higher education. In 1995, the Supreme Court had consolidated two decades of doctrinal moves towards colorblindness in a toughly worded strict scrutiny standard. That was the Adirond case. In 1996, California passed a state constitutional ban on affirmative action in public education, employment, and contracting. And the Fifth Circuit invalidated the use of affirmative action by the University of Texas Law School in the Hopwood case. Moreover, the swing vote on the Supreme Court at the time, Justice O'Connor, had played a leading role in tightening the constitutional screws on affirmative action. In 1989, she hinted that affirmative action must be, quote, strictly reserved for remedial settings. That was the Croson case. And in 1990, Metro Broadcasting, she said, modern equal protection doctrine has recognized only one compelling interest for using race, remedying the effects of racial discrimination. Thus, in 1997, when Barbara Grutter and Jennifer Gratz sued the University of Michigan, there was every reason to think that the Supreme Court was ready to close the door on using race to achieve the non-remedial goal of creating an educationally diverse student body. Ending affirmative action in higher education must certainly rank as one of the holy grails of the conservative legal movement. This is no doubt familiar to President Bush, who has spared no pains to further that movement through his judicial appointments. It is remarkable, then, that neither President Bush's speech nor the administration's brief in the Michigan cases urged the court to reject the diversity rationale. In legal terms, the administration attacked the narrow tailoring prong, attacked the Michigan policies under the narrow tailoring prong of strict scrutiny, while affirming diversity as a compelling interest. Quote, I strongly support diversity of all kinds, including racial diversity in higher education. This is President Bush in his speech. America is a diverse country, racially, economically, and ethnically, and our institutions of higher education should reflect our diversity. A college education should teach respect and understanding and goodwill, and these values are strengthened when students live and learn with people from many backgrounds. This is Bush channeling Lewis Powell. By declining to urge a categorical prohibition on the use of race, President Bush disappointed conservatives who have long insisted that anything short of a blanket rule will simply invite university officials to engage in more and more creative forms of affirmative action. So it must have been particularly galling to those conservatives that the Supreme Court, in upholding upholding educational diversity as a compelling interest, directly quoted part of the administration's brief that said, and here it is, the quote, ensuring that public institutions are open and available to all segments of American society, including people of all races and ethnicities, represents a paramount government objective. Nowhere is the importance of such openness more acute than in the context of higher education. Now, some of you may say, well, President Bush was trying to have it both ways. Support diversity, but oppose anything that actually advances it. Or perhaps the president chose the argument in a calculated way because he thought it was the one most likely to win Justice O'Connor's vote and defeat the Michigan policies. Of course, there is some element of political calculation. But at the same time, it seems to me, there is more to this story. Does President Bush really believe in diversity? Well, it's hard to answer this kind of question, but we can look for clues in at least one set of important decisions, his cabinet appointments. Over 8 years, President Bush has made 47 cabinet-level appointments. 7 were women, 10 were racial or ethnic minorities. By comparison, President Clinton made 43 appointments, of whom 8 were women and 14 were racial or ethnic minorities. President Bush's cabinet is more diverse than his father's, and it is far more diverse than the nearly all-white, all-male cabinet of Ronald Reagan. Moreover, President Bush appointed minorities to highly influential cabinet posts, most notably Colin Powell and Condoleezza Rice as Secretary of State, and Alberto Gonzalez as Attorney General. And further, as it turns out, all three individuals counseled President Bush against a broad-gauged attack on affirmative action in the Michigan cases, to the consternation of people like Solicitor General Ted Olson and other conservative administration lawyers who favored an unambiguous position against using race. The briefs that were actually filed reflect the influence of moderation and compromise to the point of incoherence. In the law school case, the administration's brief argued, for example, that the use of race-based admissions criteria is not justified in light of the ample race-neutral alternatives, and then proceeded to discuss the percentage plans implemented by Texas, Florida, and California to achieve undergraduate diversity. The obvious problem, as the Supreme Court noted in its opinion, is that, quote, the United States does not explain how such plans could work for graduate and professional schools. Loose argument of this sort is uncharacteristic of the disciplined legal work that the Solicitor General typically puts before the Supreme Court. One might say that cabinet appointments, as well as President Bush's rhetorical endorsement of diversity, are largely symbolic. But the important question is, symbolic of what? Surely it is relevant and encouraging that the past 8 years of presidential administration have continued across party lines, a trajectory that began 8 years earlier, whereby qualified women and minorities have ascended to the highest ranks of government. One might say that President Bush's position reflects a political calculation concerning the electoral fortunes of the Republican Party. Well, so what if it does? If this means we have reached a point in our nation's politics where both parties seek the votes of minority citizens, then good for us. If it means the business community and the military, both of which filed briefs supporting affirmative action, have influenced how conservatives as well as liberals see the value of diversity, then good for us. And if it means the American people, red or blue, no longer consider it unusual and have come even to expect qualified women and minorities to serve at the highest levels of government, then good for us. My point is not that diversity will be a defining feature of President Bush's legacy. My point is that the president's handling of the Michigan cases provides a lens for interpreting our nation's ongoing struggle with race. That struggle has always engaged both symbol and substance. And as we sit here today, just 2 weeks from a historic election, it is clear that symbols matter. What then of the substance? Well, let's put to one side the work of the Justice Department, which the president supervises at several layers of remove. If one were to ask President Bush to identify the signature civil rights initiative of his administration, my guess is that he would say, No Child Left Behind, a law he personally championed and helped craft based on his experience as governor of Texas. NCLB is rightly labeled, in my view, a civil rights statute for three reasons. First, it marks the first time in our nation's history that narrowing the achievement gap has been codified as a national policy priority. Second, NCLB requires schools and districts to disaggregate student achievement data by race for purposes of public reporting and accountability. The concept of unmasking disparities that broad averages would otherwise conceal is what gives No Child Left Behind its name. And third, the obligation of states, districts, and schools to close achievement gap doesn't depend on the finding of discriminatory intent or state action. Where a disparity exists, there is official responsibility to remedy it. These developments, I think, are no small thing in light of the general fatigue with race in legal doctrine and in our public culture. Now, criticisms of No Child Left Behind are as vehement as they are numerous. The law is underfunded. It has led states to lower academic standards. It gives schools an incentive to push out the low performers. It doesn't ensure that all kids have effective teachers. It is overly punitive and doesn't reward success, and the list goes on. All of these criticisms, I think, are valid to some extent, but they won't be my focus here. Instead, I want to note that whatever else might be said about NCLB, there is broad agreement that the law has made a positive contribution by requiring disaggregation of data and directing urgent attention to raising the achievement of disadvantaged children. The transparency brought about by NCLB has won praise from policymakers, researchers, and advocates across the political spectrum, and I fully support this aspect of the law. But I would like to pose a question. What kinds of schools and school districts was NCLB designed for? Or put differently, what actionable information does NCLB make available that wasn't readily available before? If you stop and think about it for a moment, racial disaggregation of achievement data is a powerful tool for transparency and accountability, but it is a tool for dealing with schools that enroll multiple racial groups. So if a school enrolls a white majority and a black or Hispanic minority, NCLB ensures that average school performance doesn't mask disparities between the groups. However, if a school is 70, 80, or even 90% black or Hispanic, there's no need to disaggregate data by race in order to learn how minority students are doing. In highly segregated schools, NCLB doesn't tell us anything new because school-wide averages do reflect the performance of the segregated group. And it is little help to say that NCLB also requires data disaggregation at the district level, not just the school level, because most highly segregated schools in America are located in highly segregated school districts. Indeed, this fact also undermines the transfer option under NCLB that allows children in low-performing schools to switch to better schools in the same district. Where low-performing schools are located in low-performing districts, the transfer option is illusory. The unfortunate fact is that most racial minorities who live in concentrated poverty attend segregated schools in segregated districts that do not provide a high-quality education. Consider, for example, the public schools of Detroit, 91% black. These are district-level figures, not school-level figures. Los Angeles, 73% Latino. Baltimore, 89% black. Santa Ana, California, 93% Latino. New Orleans, 94% black. El Paso, 81% Latino. In these districts, what do we know under NCLB that we didn't know before? If sunshine and shame are NCLB's principal contribution to the education landscape, then NCLB has added very little to improving racially isolated, high-poverty schools and school districts. For we have long known, well before NCLB, that those schools and districts are struggling and often lack the basic building blocks for change. My point is not that NCLB is bad policy. I think, actually, it is on balance a step forward in the evolution of a federal role dedicated to equalizing educational opportunity. My point, rather, is that the policy levers in NCLB, such as disaggregation of school and district data and the school transfer option within the district, are woefully mismatched to the scale and severity of the challenges. Unequal educational opportunity is rooted in complex policy choices that isolate children racially and socioeconomically, in school finance systems that do not adequately provide for the needs of disadvantaged children, in teacher policies that end up assigning the most inexperienced teachers to the most challenging schools, and in structures of education governance that tend to preserve the status quo rather than help the least advantaged. NCLB is simply not designed to address these systemic structural problems. And yet, they are among the most important civil rights issues we face today. So the lesson learned from NCLB, I think, is that we do not yet have a national policy agenda specifically designed to improve the education of minority children who live in concentrated poverty. The chronic nature of unequal educational opportunity has a somewhat desensitizing quality. Over the years, I think, we have found more and more ways to conceal, to contain, or to cope with this problem than to seriously tackle and resolve it. The issue kind of simmers at a low boil with no clear moment that calls for decisive action. But if there ever was an opportunity in recent times to forge a national consensus for a new civil rights agenda, it was in the days and weeks after August 29, 2005, when Hurricane Katrina killed over 1,800 people and displaced 700,000 others along the Gulf Coast. Next to 9/11, Katrina was the single most consequential catastrophic event to occur during the Bush presidency. And the social challenges that affirmative action and NCLB tend to obscure are precisely the ones that Katrina laid bare. You know, natural disasters are sometimes said to be great equalizers of society. As Katrina showed, nothing could be further from the truth. A good deal of attention has focused on the incompetent response to the hurricane at all levels of government and the racially disparate impact of the destruction and ensuing misery. But far less attention has been focused on why the black citizens of New Orleans were so disproportionately harmed by Katrina. As a junior senator from Illinois said at the time, quote, "The people of New Orleans weren't just abandoned during the hurricane, they were abandoned long ago." The racial history of New Orleans is, in many ways, paradigmatic of the development of many American cities, involving a virulent combination of school segregation, housing segregation, migration of people and jobs away from minority neighborhoods, inadequate public transportation, and selective indifference to mitigating environmental hazard. This has long been a foolproof recipe for racial segregation and concentrated poverty. And what Katrina revealed is that apart from the criminal justice system, we don't really have a coherent social policy to address the intersection of race and poverty in America, nor do we have the political leadership necessary for the task. A few days after the levees broke, a reporter called me to ask an interesting question. She said, "Does the government's response to Katrina raise any constitutional questions?" Well, you know, as a pointy-headed law professor, I proceeded to explain that our courts generally do not recognize positive rights to government assistance, and that the disparities revealed by Katrina were unlikely to be actionable given the difficulties of proving intentional discrimination. But on reflection, however, I came to feel that my lawyerly answer did not respond to the true angle of her question, which was motivated, I think, by the common sense observation that something had gone terribly wrong in our democracy when the cleavages of race and class play out with such severe and noxious consequences. I think Robin West, professor at Georgetown, may have captured the reporter's intuition when she wrote that, quote, "The failure of local, state, and federal authorities to protect the poor in the city of New Orleans against the ravages of that poverty in the aftermath of Hurricane Katrina and the breach in the levees that came in its wake constitutes the greatest constitutional failure of our young democracy, at least since the advent of Jim Crow." To my mind, the tragedy of Katrina has four dimensions. First, the devastation caused by the hurricane itself. Second, the indignity and suffering caused by the government response. Third, the glaring disparities in suffering caused by decades of public inattention and indeed facilitation of the underlying conditions that poor African Americans faced in New Orleans. And fourth, the enormous missed opportunity for presidential leadership to renew America's commitment to equality. This last point, I think, deserves some emphasis, for it is not often that the nation is forced to confront its shortcomings in so prominently and pointedly a way. The media images of Katrina, and who could forget them, left us with nowhere to hide. We could not shift our gaze elsewhere. In that moment of rapt attention, and dare I say, empathy, there was an opportunity to unite the nation behind a new agenda to attack poverty and racial inequality. There was a window in which a leader could have stood up and said, "This is not right." But the moment passed, and so did the opportunity. Today, and for the foreseeable future, when it comes to galvanizing the American people in support of a national imperative, no institution of government rivals the modern presidency. That was not the intent of the framers, but it is a fact of the nation we have become. A president can speak directly to the people in one voice. A president can set the agenda and stay the course for a sustained period of time. A president can do the hard work of policy implementation necessary to bring about change. A president can articulate a vision responsive to the nation in its entirety, not just to one of its parts. And a president can translate the Constitution into the language of justice without fear of overstepping his authority. In short, a president can lead, and because he can lead, I would argue that he must. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. We're running a little late, but we've got time for just a couple of questions, and then maybe those of you who have further things you'd like to say could come down in front and we could talk informally. But have I got any takers, or are we all concerned about getting to the next class? Any questions? Yes, sir.
I just recently came down here from Washington, D.C., and at the time that I left, NCLB reauthorization was one of the biggest questions in the newspapers and on everyone's mind. What do you think the prospects are in a new administration for a reauthorization of NCLB to include some of the kinds of reforms that you're actually talking about?
Good question. So no matter who is elected this fall, NCLB will be on the table for discussion again in 2009. I don't think the prospects are good that NCLB will be reauthorized as NCLB. Every president who passes this law, which is essentially a reauthorization of the Elementary and Secondary Education Act of 1965, has to put a new name on this law. And the unfortunate thing, I think, is that No Child Left Behind has come to stand for something larger than life. And so the name, I think, will change. The question, I think, is whether or not we will get something like NCLB 2.0, or will we get NCLB 1.1, right? Will it be changes kind of at the margins, or will it be a wholesale revision of the whole approach? In order to be a 2.0, I think it will require presidential leadership. The problem with presidential leadership is that if you look out on the horizon of the number of issues that are going on out there, the economy, Iraq, healthcare, global climate change, education is one of six or seven things competing for very serious attention. So I think that's kind of the choice that's involved here. Is it going to be small fixes, you know, which can be done through the cabinet at the cabinet level or through a sub-presidential level, or is it going to be a big change, which will really require, I think, the desk to be cleared from the president for at least to some extent, and room made to really take on this set of issues. The fragile coalition that passed NCLB, which was a bipartisan one, has basically broken apart. The conservatives feel they were duped because the federal role was too heavy-handed, and the liberals feel they were duped because the funding never came for the law. So to break that logjam, they're going to need to propose something radically different that appeals to both sides.
Recent studies have shown that approximately 20% of the African Americans in the United States don't have a valid driver's license, and it's a voting trend in many states now to require that at the booth. Do you think this is something that will change in a new administration?
Well, so there are federal laws that deal with access to voter registration. And that your question goes to actually being at the polls and having entitlement to vote. Of course, the Supreme Court has basically deferred this issue. And we will, because they said that, you know, a facial challenge to this kind of law, there's sort of insufficient evidence on either side to really make up a broad ruling one way or the other. That was the Crawford case from Indiana this past year. This has been sort of a pattern of the Supreme Court saying, we don't want to decide things until they are squarely presented in a concrete, specific case. The problem, of course, is that by the time it's been presented, the election is over, and then we're only making decisions for the next election. But we'll see. I mean, one thing to watch, I think, this November is what kind of important litigation arises out of the massive numbers of new voters that are going to the polls. I can only imagine that there will be some, you know, I hope some of you have signed up to be poll watchers, because those of you who are trained in the law really need to participate in that process. There will be problems. And so this issue, I think, is going to percolate as a result of this election and the midterm election to come for the next few years. And maybe by 2012, you know, we'll have a clearer sense of what the ground rules are.
Goodwin, thanks very much.
Thanks a lot.